Hi Jayashree, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. All right. Is my audio and video clear?
Yes, sir.
Awesome. Okay. Yeah, Jayashree, I think you can just share your screen. Okay, yes, we can see your slides. You want to try changing the slides just to see the
One second. Yes,
transitions? Yeah, perfect. Yeah. The transitions are slightly slower over the Zoom meeting, but that's okay. I think we can just leave it there.
Okay, sir.
Okay, just give me a minute. I'll be back.
Yes, sir.
Yes, so good evening, Dr. Jayashree. How are you? How is everything at Savita Dental College?
Yes, sir, everything is doing fine.
Everything's going fine. So getting back to normal, the new normal.
Yes, sir, we have like last COVID itself, in the sense, in first lockdown itself, we started working. So it has transformed to a normal thing. There is no confusion in it.
Okay, nice. All right. Good. So, yes, we'll wait for a couple of minutes.
Yes, sir.
Students will be joining in. Yeah, so we've gone YouTube live right now. Okay, so I think students would be joining in sometime. Nevertheless, it's 6 o'clock, so I think we can start this off. All right, good evening, everyone who's joined us in for PhD 101 National Rapid Revision Series. Today we have with us Dr. Jayashree, who's presently working as senior lecturer in the Department of Public Health Dentistry at the Savita Dental College and Hospital, Chennai. And a little bit of introduction about our speaker for today. Dr. Jayashree has completed a Bachelor of Dental Surgery from Meenakshi Amal Dental College in the year 2010 and Master's of Dental Surgery in Public Health Dentistry from Savita University, 2017. Her main areas of interest include epidemiology, biostatistics, research methodology, and medical ethics, social sciences, nutrition, and the current concepts in dentistry and preventive dentistry. She's also had an experience of working as a junior resident at the Stanley Medical College and Hospital, Chennai, in the year 2011. She's also been working, had previously as a BDS tutor at Savira Dental College. I think after that, she continued for her post-graduation there. So presently working as senior lecturer at Savira Dental College. Now a little bit about Dr. Jayashree in terms of the academic experience. I must say at a very young age, she has accomplished several feats that includes a lot of international level conferences and workshops, which she has to her credit of having participated in various domains. And also when we talk about her scientific publications, she's had a total publications of 77, in which the 9 are PubMed indexed and Scopus 58 and Web of Science. So with this wide academic experience, Jayashree happens to be one of the forefront runners of public health dentistry. And we're so happy and proud to have her with us today to take up such an important session, which is minimal intervention dentistry. Now, all of you UGs, PGs who are attending this and are watching this over YouTube, you must have constantly wondered the question of MID, which features in many of your papers in undergraduation, right? So be it your public health dentistry paper where we study components of MID, or be it your conservative paper, endodontics, and also in periodontics. The whole idea of minimal intervention dentistry or minimally invasive dentistry or micro dentistry, as we say, has been sort of restructuring and reshaping the conventional approach for management of dental caries. So as we grow towards for more of an extension for prevention to conservation for prevention, I thought it was really imperative for us to learn about the basic fundamentals here. And a quick note of to all the postgraduates, it's also a potential paper 4 question. So just watch out for all the points and all the review articles and try to learn as much as possible. And I'm really hoping that this session will be really helpful for all of you here. So with that brief introduction, I'd like to welcome Dr. Jayashree onto the panel of PAEHT 101 for a session today. Thank you so much for accepting to do this and for making it possible. So over to you, Jayashree.
It's my pleasure, Dr. Dempsey Lawrence. So good evening, one and all. Hope everybody is doing fine. So before I start with my presentation, I would like to thank once again Dr. Dempsey Lawrence and my friend Dr. Shivashankar for providing me this opportunity to deliver my virtual presentation on microdentistry. So microdentistry is also called as minimal invasive dentistry or minimal intervention dentistry, where we are supposed to reshape the traditional or the conventional approach for the management of dental caries. So as we all know, dental caries is a multifactorial disease wherein the tooth, the oral microbial flora, and also the refined carbohydrates and along with saliva, all these factors will contribute to the caries initiation and progression. So identifying these risk factors and controlling them is very important to prevent demineralization of the tooth. So in this slide, you can see the caries balance. So the caries balance is between the protective factors and pathological factors. What are the protective factors which can provide, which can prevent the caries initiation as well as the progression? So the protective factors are the salivary flow and the components. The salivary flow and components are nothing but the salivary antibodies. And then we have a pH of the saliva buffering capacity, all these factors will act as a protective factors. So the other one will be your oral clearance rate. The oral clearance rate should be adequate, okay, in order to prevent the retention of sticky food substances onto the occlusal or the smooth surface of the tooth. And then use of oral hygiene measures, that is proper maintenance of oral hygiene with the help of antibacterial agents such as fluoride mouth rinses, fluoridated toothpaste. And the final one will be your remineralization agents, which can be calcium, phosphate, and fluoride as well. So what are the pathological factors which contribute to caries? The pathological factors are nothing but the dietary fermentable carbohydrates, high bacterial count, which will be your streptococcus mutants. Streptococcus mutants are responsible for the initiation of dental caries. And then for the progression of dental caries, lactobacilli plays a role. So followed by reduced salivary function. All these factors will contribute to caries initiation and progression. So, what is a minimal intervention or microdentistry or minimal invasive dentistry? So, drilling and filling the tooth is not the only solution to the damage caused by the caries process, and it cannot be an effective solution to treat the cariogenic infection. Therefore, we have transformed this traditional approach from drilling and filling the tooth to a minimal intervention, which is a modern approach. So what is MID? So according to Mount and Yuma, MID is nothing but it implies a systematic respect for the human or the original tooth structure. Okay, it is a systematic respect for the original tooth structure, and it has reshaped the G.V. Black's concept of extension for prevention to prevention of extension. So what are the milestones in the development of MID? Between the year 1836 and 1915, G.V. Black reported that all the softened and then the discolored caries tooth structure needs to be removed, and then the wall should be extended to achieve a caries-free area. And in the year 1923, Hayek proposed the prophylactic odontomy, which is nothing but where the deep pith and fissures are restored with the small restorations. And in the year 1929, Bodeker proposed the concept of enameloplasty, that is where the deep pith and fissures will be broadened with the help of an large round burr to make the occlusal areas more self-cleansing. And in the year 1955, the Bonacor introduced the acid etch technique. And in the year 1970, Graham and Mount are the people who are the first people to introduce the concept of MID. And then in 1974, Dan Erickson presented the MID technique to the world. And then in 1976, the glass ionomer Simmons were introduced. Simpson and Stallard are the people who introduced the concept of preventive resin restorations and resin-based sealant during the year 1978. And during the year 1980 and 1988, ART was pioneered in Tasmania, and its use was started in clinics. ART is nothing but atraumatic restorative treatment. So what are the main principles of MID? According to World Dental Federation, there are four main principles of MID, which includes reduction of cariogenic microflora, remineralizing the early caries lesion with the help of remineralizing agents, and performing minimal intervention followed by repairing the tooth rather than replacing the defective restoration. So I will repeat once again, there are four main principles of PID, MID, which includes reduction of cariogenic flora, remineralizing the early caries lesion using a remineralizing agent, performing minimal intervention or minimal intervention techniques, and followed by repairing rather than replacing the defective restoration. The three important tools of MID includes to identify, to prevent, and to restore. So identifying the caries lesion at its earliest stage by checking the oral hygiene status of the patient, the plaque accumulation, the salivary pH, the buffering capacity of the saliva, and also the bacterial count in the saliva. So we need to identify the caries risk at the early stage itself, followed by preventing the demineralization and also promoting remineralization, and by maintaining the maximum amount of tooth structure. So we need to prevent the demineralization followed by promoting remineralization. And the last one will be restoring the tooth by minimal intervention techniques. Okay, so that we can maintain the maximum amount of healthy tooth tissues. So the main tools of MID includes identifying the caries risk at early stage, preventing the demineralization, promoting remineralization, and restoring the tooth by minimal intervention techniques. So I will be explaining all these factors in my upcoming slides. So identifying. So we need to identify the caries risk, which can be done with the help of caries risk assessment. So the caries risk assessment include dietary analysis. So it can be recorded by means of diet diary, that is diet diary chart, which includes 24 hours chart or 3rd, 5th, and 7th days record of food intake. So we need to calculate the total food score. That is, the dental health diet score needs to be calculated based on the food score, the nutrient score, and also the sweet score. So the food score, there are 5 groups. That is, we have milk, meat, fruits and vegetables, vitamin C, bread and cereals. So we need to collect the data for the portion size and also the number of servings. So the number of servings and followed by we need to multiply by a constant value. For milk, it is 8. For meat, it is 12. And then for the rest, it is 6. Then when it comes to nutrient score, here we won't be multiplying by the number of servings with any number. So here the value will be constant. If a patient consumes milk or meat more than once in a day, also will be considered as a score given will be 7, followed by the sweet score. The sweet score we have to categorize into a liquid, a solid and sticky, and then slowly dissolving. Here we will be multiplying with the frequency. For liquid it will be 5, solid and sticky it will be 10, and slowly dissolving will be 15. So all this value will enable us to find the caries risk of the patient. So for first we discussed about the diet diary. The second will be our oral hygiene status. We need to check the oral hygiene status of the patient, which can be done with the help of oral hygiene index simplified. So the oral hygiene index simplified records the debris and as well as the calculus score. So the debris and calculus score we need to sum up to get the oral hygiene index score. So it is calculated, it is recorded based on the indexed teeth. They are 1611, 26, 36, 31, and 46. So based on these indexed teeth, we need to calculate the oral hygiene score and the final interpretation will be given in the form of good, fair, and poor. So diet diary is over. Then we discussed about the oral hygiene status. And then the third one will be your plaque accumulation. So the plaque accumulation can be identified by means of plaque disclosing solution. So the name itself implies disclosing. So we need to disclose the invisible plaque and make it visible to the naked eye, which can be done by means of a disclosing solution. So disclosing solution by definition, it is a preparation available either in a liquid, tablet or lozenge form which contains dye or other in coloring agents. So which is used for bacterial identification, that is bacterial plaque identification. So when it is applied to the tooth surface, it imparts color to the tooth as well as it can act as a visual aid for patient instruction. So the plaque disclosing solution can be a mercurochrome solution, an iodine solution, a two-tone solution or a single-tone solution. Now recently, they have developed a fluorescent-based disclosing solution as well. So this disclosing solution will enable us to identify the plaque and also it can act as a visual aid for patient instruction. Then evaluation of the caries activity. It can be done by means of microbial analysis. We have various microbial tests. That is, we have a lactobacillus count test, streptococcus count test, Nida's test, Alban's test, and then we have swab test. So the lactobacillus and streptococcus count test can be performed by collecting the saliva from the patient. Then we need to dilute the saliva in the ratio of 1:2000 using a saline solution, followed by we need to transfer the solution to an agar plate. That is, we use with the help of a rod using a Stope method. Then we need to calculate the interpretation of the lactobacillus count is as follows. That is, when it is between 0 to 1000, the caries activity will be little. When it fluctuates, when it ranges between 1000 to 5000, it will be considered as slight caries activity. between 5,000 to 10,000 moderate caries activity, and more than 10,000 will be marked caries activity. When it comes to streptococcus mutans, the procedure will be the same. And then when you have a count more than 1 lakh per ml in saliva, it indicates a high caries risk. The next test will be colorimetric NIDAS test. So in colorimetric NIDAS test is the one which enables us, it has the ability for the salivary microorganisms to form the organic acids from a carbohydrate medium. So it measures the ability to for the karyogenic microorganisms to form the organic acids from a carbohydrate medium. This medium contains a bromocrosal green dye. So the dye will change its color from green to yellow. If yellow, that is, you can see the interpretation that we need to incubate for 24 hours. If the solution remains yellow, we can say it as marked caries susceptibility. If it changes, if it is green, we need to continue incubating and observe at 48 hours. So first we need to incubate at 24 hours. If the solution turns to yellow, there will be marked caries susceptibility. If it is green, then it will be, we need to continue to incubate and observe for 48 hours. At 48 hours, if the solution changes to yellow, then it is considered to be definite caries susceptibility. If it still remains green, then again we need to incubate and observe at 72 hours. Then at 72 hours, if the solution remains yellow, it will be considered as limited caries susceptibility. Then if it is green, then we can say it as caries inactive patients. So Albrand's test is a modification of modified NIDAS test. It's a modification of colorimetric NIDAS test. Here we will be using a test tube where we can identify the color change. No color change will be considered as negative. Beginning of the color change in the test tube will be considered as 1 plus, 1 of color change 2 plus, 3/4 color change 3 plus, and total color change to yellow will be 4 plus. And then in case of a swab test, we need to collect the sample from the buccal surfaces, and then it will be transferred to a saline solution and followed by recording the pH using a pH meter. So the pH of the solution is between 4.1 or less than 4.1. More than 4.1 will be considered as marked caries. And when it is between 4.2 to 4.4, active caries. 4.5 to 4.6, slightly active. And 4.6 and over, it will be considered as less active. And salivary buffering capacity. Therefore, the saliva of individuals whose mouth contains considerable amount of caries lesion frequently have lower acid buffering capacity than the saliva of those who are relatively caries free. So these are the tests used to assess the caries risk. So we have an lactobacillus and streptococcus mutans test, NIDAS test, then Albrand's test, swab test, and salivary buffer capacity test. The fifth one will be karyogram. So the karyogram, it is nothing but an software where we need to give, where we need to input few details, that is the caries experience, the related disease, diet content, diet frequency. When you input all these details, pie chart will be automatically generated. So based on this pie chart, the interpretation will be as follows. So when there is a small green sector, then there is low chance to avoid caries and the patients are at high risk. When there is a large green sector, there is high chance to avoid caries and the patients are considered to be low risk patient. Then we can also use caries risk assessment form given by American Dental Association. We have it for age group between 0 to 6 and also above 6 years old. Next one will be early detection of caries. So we need to identify the caries by checking the oral hygiene status. So we recorded the diet chart, the oral hygiene index, then plaque accumulation, then microbial analysis, then will be our early detection of caries. So the early detection of caries will be by means of visual tactile method or the radiographic method, and then we have electrical conductance measurement. measurement and laser. So I will repeat once again, we can detect the caries at an early stage by means of visual tactile method, radiographic method, electrical conductance measurement and laser. So visual method is by means of early caries lesion, that is we need to visually examine the white spot lesion, any discoloration, cavitation, and tactile method by use of mouth mirror and also an explorer. And radiographic method, use of a conventional bite wing radiograph to detect the incipient caries lesion, and also digital radiography, that is RVG. It can be considered to be better stored of the all the details and also the better quality, and it includes the database which contains the radiographic patterns of the sound teeth. Then laser. Laser is by qualitative laser fluorescence, where it is nothing but a light induced fluorescence based method of caries detection. So we have a green color. You can see in this image where you can see a green color will be considered as a normal tooth structure. A blue color indicates a demineralization or incipient caries lesion. Red colors indicates a caries, and also plaque indicating the bacterial presence. And then we have something called alternating current impedance spectroscopy. It is nothing but use of a multiple electrical frequency to detect the caries. So the Caries Scan Pro is the one which is available, commercially available in the market, where lower readings indicate little or no caries and higher readings indicate caries are likely. So we are done with identification, that is by finding out the caries risk by means of diet chart, oral hygiene index, plaque accumulation, then followed by microbial analysis. And then we also discussed about the early detection of caries by conventional method, radiographic method, that is visual tactile method, use of a conventional radiograph, bite wing radiograph, RVG, and also we had a QLF, quantitative laser fluorescence, and then we had electrical frequencies to detect the caries. Then the next one, followed by identification, will be prevention. So prevention can be done by rebalancing the oral environment, approach to remineralization and surface protection. So we need to rebalance the oral environment. Then we need to approach to remineralization of the tooth structure and also surface protection. So rebalancing the oral environment, it can be done by means of maintaining a proper oral hygiene, use of antibacterial agents such as chlorhexidine mouth rinse or anticariogenic agents like fluoride mouth rinses, and limit the intake of refined carbohydrates or sugar or sticky food. So approach to remineralization. For prevention, first we need to rebalance the oral environment, then followed by remineralization. So it can be done by means of topical fluoride. So what is a topical fluoride? Topical fluoride is nothing but a system which contains relatively larger concentration of fluoride, which is applied locally or topically on the erected tooth surfaces to prevent dental caries formation. So I will repeat once again, by definition, topical fluoride is nothing but a system which contains a relatively larger concentration of fluoride, which can be applied locally or topically on the erected tooth surfaces to prevent dental caries formation. So what are the types of topical fluoride? It can be a operator administered or a self-administered. So operator administers are nothing but the professionally applied topical fluoride, and then we have self-administered. So operator administered are further classified into fluoride solution, fluoride gels and fluoride varnishes. Self-administration can be done by means of fluoride dentifiers and fluoride mouth rinses. So topical fluoride, it can be a self-administered or a professionally applied topical fluoride. Professionally applied topical fluorides are the fluoride solutions, fluoride gels and fluoride varnishes. And self-administered are the fluoride dentifiers and fluoride mouth rinses. So professionally applied topical fluoride, we have 2% sodium fluoride, 8% stannous fluoride, and then we have acetylated phosphate fluoride 1.23% concentration available in solution as well as gel form. And then we have fluoride varnish, that is DuraFat and fluor protector. So after a thorough oral prophylaxis, we need to apply the either we can follow a paint on technique or by use of a fluoride tracer. So the professionally applied topical fluoride available, like a commercially available professionally applied topical fluorides are 2% sodium fluoride, 8% stannous fluoride, APF 1.23% concentration. It is available in gel as well as solution form. And then we have fluoride varnish, that is DuraFat and fluor protector. So the method can be by means of paint on technique or by use of a fluoride tracer. The self-administered fluoride are the, you have fluoride mouth rinses and also fluoride dentifrices, which contain sodium monofluorophosphate and also sodium fluoride. Non-fluoride remineralizing agents are CPP and ACP, which is nothing but cysteine phosphopeptide, and then we have amorphous calcium phosphate. So Ricaldent is the which is a dental chewing gum, which contains CPP and ACP, and GC Toothmouse is a dentifrice which contains CPP and ACP. And then we have Enamelon, where it contains unstabilized amorphous calcium phosphate, where the calcium and phosphate salt will be delivered separately intraorally. And then we have Novamine technology, which includes a bioactive glass. A Clinpro tooth cream is a commercially available organically modified tricalcium phosphate with fluoride. And then we have Toothmin, which is a caries protect. It's a mixture of calcium, sucrose, mono and diphosphate, disucrose monophosphate. So these are the remineralizing agents. So to summarize, if a patient is at developing low caries risk, or is a patient that is at low caries risk, you can advise 1000 ppm fluoride twice daily. And then Ricaldent, that is ACP and CPP are not needed in this case. And also Chlorhexidine once daily after lunch for 4 weeks, and then we need to recall the patient. And then use of fluoride varnish once annually is enough for this patients who fall into the category of low caries risk. So I will repeat once again, those who fall into the category of low caries risk, we need to advise 1000 ppm of the fluoridated toothpaste twice daily. Ricaldent is not required, and then Chlorhexidine mouth rinse, and also fluoride varnish annual application once in a year. Then high caries risk, 1000 ppm of fluoride twice daily, and then we have to advise MI paste, that is which contains ACP and CPP, and also Chlorhexidine mouth rinse once daily after lunch for 4 weeks, and then review the oral bacteria and reduce the frequency gradually. And then for fluoride varnish, monthly initially, then we need to reduce to several times annually. So prevention, so identification followed by prevention. So the prevention can also be done by means of surface protection. So surface protection, first we have changed the oral environment. Then we spoke about all the remineralizing agents. Now for surface protection. Surface protection can be done by means of pit and fissure sealants. So according to American Dental Association, sealants on permanent molars reduce the caries risk by 80%. So what is a sealant? By definition given by Simpson, it is nothing but a material which is introduced into the pit and fissures of caries susceptible tooth, which forms a micromechanically bonded protective layers, and also cutting the access of the cariogenic bacteria from that nutrient source. So I will repeat once again, this definition is given by Simpson, where we will be introducing a material into the deep occlusal pit and fissures, which forms a micromechanically bonded protective layer, and therefore it cuts the access of the oral bacteria from its nutrient source. I mean karyogenic bacteria from its nutrient source. What are the classification of sealants based on generation? That is, first generation is UV light, and we have an example alpha seal. Second generation is self-cured. They are example concise white sealant Delton. And third generation is a blue visible light. Example will be Stephen Strang. These are commercially available products. And fourth generation, where we have fluoride releasing sealant, which is an added benefit. We have Clean Pro, and then Tom I. Morphis and Jack Tauber. Clean Pro is the commonest one which we are using in our clinical practice, which is a resin based fluoride releasing and color changing sealant. So what is the main disadvantage of an resin based sealant is moisture contamination or micro leakage. Usually the sealant will adhere to the enamel surface by means of micromechanically bonded or by means of interlocking resin tags. But when there is a moisture or a salivary contamination, it inhibits the adherence of the sealant to the enamel surface. So in order to avoid, in order to overcome this problem, hydrophilic sealants have been introduced. That is, we have something called Embrace Wet Bond and Ultra Seal XT Hydro. These are moisture tolerant hydrophilic sealant. That is, it can adhere to the enamel moist surfaces. So identification is over, prevention by means of remineralizing agents, and then restoration. So restorations can be done by means of minimal intervention techniques. So in MIT concept, restoration is the last resort. So the cavitation where the restoration is done for aesthetic and function, and we replace, that is repair of defective restoration rather by replacing them. What are the principles of MI techniques? We need to conserve, that is we need to follow a conservative cavity preparation. The shape of the cavity will be dictated only by the caries, and it is unique for each caries lesion. So first one will be conservative cavity preparation. And second is, demineralized enamel and infected denting should be removed, and the affected denting can be left behind. And then adduction. That is, undermined enamel cavity can be restored with an adhesive materials. And then use of biomimetic restorative material. That is, it returns the damaged tooth to its functional, biological, and aesthetic property. So the four principles of MI techniques will be conservative cavity preparation, removal of demineralized enamel and infected dentin, and then adhesion, and followed by biomimetic restorative material usage. So what are the cavity designs used for minimal intervention techniques are the tunnel preparation and slot cavity preparation. So the tunnel preparation is a technique was proposed by Wilson and McLean in the year 1988, where it is indicated for the lesion more than 2.5 mm below the crest of the marginal ridge. And the contact area may remain sound, and the marginal ridge may be quite strong. And we use a resin modified glass ionomer cement for tunnel preparation. And slot cavity preparation for lesion less than 2.5 mm below the crest of the marginal ridge. Well, the main objective is we will be removing the tooth structure that has broken beyond the possibility of remineralization. So we will be removing only the tooth structure that has broken beyond the possibility of remineralization. So cavity designs followed by atraumatic restorative treatment. So the atraumatic restorative treatment approach was pioneered in Tanzania in the year 1980s as a part of community-based primary oral health program by the University of Dar es Salaam. So what is the, there are two principles of atraumatic restorative treatment. That is removal of a caries lesion using an AND instrument and followed by restoring the tooth with an adhesive material, that is a glass ionomer cement. So the what are the advantages of this treatment is it causes less trauma to the tooth structure and also low cost, and followed by chemical adhesion and fluoride releasing agent. And the instruments used are there. You have a chisel. You can use a chisel and also a spoon excavator. So what is an atraumatic restorative treatment? It is nothing but removal of a caries lesion using a hand instrument followed by placement of an GIC cement. Okay, it can be done only when there is an open caries lesion and there should be no involvement of pulp. The other techniques will be air abrasion. So air abrasion is, this instrument was developed in the year 1940 by Dr. Robert Black. It is an effective alternative to a standard dental drill. So how it acts, that is, the caries lesion can be removed by a stream of aluminium oxide particles generated from the compressed air. So we have so many KCP series, micro prep and creative, all these are considered to be the air abrasion instruments. Next one will be chemo-mechanical caries removal. So all this will fall under restoring, that is restoring the tooth by minimal intervention techniques. Okay, so we discussed about the cavity designs, then we discussed about the various instruments used, then atraumatic restorative treatment. Now will be chemo-mechanical caries removal. So chemo-mechanical caries removal is nothing but softening the denting by the application of a chemical agent followed by removal of the caries with the help of a spoon excavator. How it acts? The amino acids will react with sodium hypochlorite in that material and it forms an N-monochloroamino acids which will selectively degrade the demineralized collagen in the caries dentin. So the various preparations are, we have Carisol, we have Papa Cari, these are commercially available products. So in chemo-mechanical caries removal, where we soften the dentin by the application of chemical agent and we remove the caries lesion with the help of a spoon excavator. The lasers. So the commonly used lasers are ER and YAG laser, that is erbium, yttrium, aluminium, garnet. We have three different wavelengths, that is 2.94, 78 and 2.79. So to summarize MID, so we first need to identify the caries at the early stage by checking the oral hygiene status, the plaque accumulation, the pH of the saliva, the salivary buffering capacity, and also the bacteria count. Then we need to prevent the demineralization and promote remineralization, and then restore the tooth structure by means of minimal intervention techniques and maintaining the maximum amount of tooth structure, and followed by recall the patient. What are the benefits of MID? So prevention of demineralization, remineralization, and then reducing the patient anxiety, which in turn can impact better oral health. So to conclude, as an astute dentist, we need to implement the various concepts or the various phases of MID for the prevention of dental caries, and also to offer an good health environment for the victorious management of these kind of dental caries. Thank you, sir. These are my references. Thank you.
All right. So that was a very comprehensive session, Jayashree. Thank you so much for that. I think when you look into minimal intervention dentistry, there's so many things, and there has been a radical, or rather a paradigm shift, in how we address the management of dental caries, right? Especially on a day-to-day basis and clinical practice, with so many newer technologies which have come into our practice of dentistry. This has become all the more important, and it's really imperative for us to know the approach, especially the way you summarized that. Identifying and then eventually up to recall, restore, all of that in that whole, the crux of the entire topic per se, if you have to look at it, it all revolves around identification, prevention. So it's more like, and I really like the way you put in all the pictorial representative, you know, the fishbone towards the end and all of that. So I think that's, those are really very good takeaways from today's session. And like I said, we can also put this as a part of a jigsaw puzzle where, you know, things fit into each other. So it's very important for us to identify, and not just for public health dentists, but in general practice as well. So thank you so much for that. I think if we can open the house for discussion now, anybody wants to ask any questions, please use the chat box, or you could just raise your hand, or I think you can unmute yourself and ask the question directly to Jayashree. Yes, Dr. Deepak. Yeah, go on.
Good evening, sir and ma'am. Ma'am, I had a doubt regarding nutritional evaluation score.
Yes.
It was like, do we do the nutritional evaluation score for 5-day recall dietary chart?
Can you please repeat the question? I'm unable to
understand. Ma'am, question is, ma'am, when we are doing a 5-day nutritional dietary recall, how do we record the nutritional evaluation score for 5 days?
So it will be based on the food group, nutrient, and also the sweet score. So we need to evaluate the patient for 5 days. And then final score, we need to calculate, that is like food score, we need to sum up the food and then the nutrient, followed by we need to minus the sweet score. So it will get it will give you the total health diet score. So based on this score, we can say whether if you get a score above 64, we can say the patient is indicated for dietary counseling and they are at high caries risk.
Ma'am, isn't it, like ma'am, I'm asking it pertaining to the 5-day dietary recall.
5 days, we need to sum up for each day, we need to calculate 24 hours. That hey, diet.
For the food, like you have the food group score, then yes, you have the sweet score. Particularly, yes, I'm asking you in relation to the nutritional evaluation score, ma'am. The nutrition one, the, where you are scoring for 8.
The nutrient score will be like 7. It will be like common for all the nutrients. There is no need to multiply or anything. Like for example, if patient is consuming meat more than twice a day, it will be considered as only 7 for that day.
Okay. Then what is about like for a 5-day, it will be how it will be scored for 5 days? Like if, like for a ma'am, for 5, for food group, like for 5, for food group.
I got your point. Like if it is for 24 hours, it is like a score of 7. When it comes to 5 days, do we need to sum up, right?
Yes, ma'am. How do we sum up? Like, can you?
In that case, only for 24 hours you calculate, okay. Then you recall the patient for like, in the sense like third day you recall the patient and find out whether there is a difference between the initial score and also the post score.
Like for example, ma'am, even if we are not recalling, we can compare it from the already given chart for 5 days.
We have a chart. You can refer a textbook. Okay, it is the author of the textbook is Nicel. Okay, yes, so ma'am, there are some interpretation values given. I am unable to remember those values, but they are clearly explained. This, which I have discussed, is only for 24 hours. So you have it separately for 3rd and 5th and 7th day also. So they have given the scores. You can follow the book. The author of the textbook is Nicel, Nizel.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, so that was a query related to the nutritional assessment. Any other queries from anybody else, please go ahead and you can ask the presenter for today. Otherwise, I think you can also use the chat box and let us know there. Please do post in there. Meanwhile, I'll just take a moment to thank and acknowledge Dr. Jayashree for the session today. I think it's been really voluminous and really comprehensive, I should say, you know, in terms of how we've learned the various aspects. And for postgraduates, like I said, this will be very helpful. We shall be sharing the presentation along with the recording of today, which is on YouTube for further reference. So some of you are asking for the references, right? So in our student learning groups, you can always join in our PhD 101 student groups. I've put the link on the chat box, so you can get the slides of today's presentation. And quickly, if we have any other questions, go ahead, guys. UGs, PGs, anybody here, you can always ask before we can wrap up for today. All right, so I think that should be a wrap for today. If you have any more questions, of course, you can always write to us. You can let us know in detail also. And of course, you can look up on our website. It's always there. The content is available for everybody here. So you are always free to reach out to us and look out for any help assistance. All the notifications and queries will be addressed if you can write to us. The details are there on the website. And like I guess said, PhD 101 is really dedicated for public health industry. And we are really happy to have Dr. Jayashree today join our panel and give us experience and knowledge and expertise in this very important topic for today. And with that, I think, thank you so much, Jayashree, for doing this and for making it happen. And I think that must be a wrap for today. If there aren't any other questions, I think we can quickly wrap up for today. Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much.